In covering the meeting today, we've had a lot of a focus on the National Health Regulator, but one of the points that I would make is that the problems that relate to that aspect of regulation relate to all the parts of regulation of healthcare across all the professions. I think David Dahm has talked about how we can adopt the model of another profession to make it much safer for us across all, including coronial medicine. Were you concentrating on that slide? Do you know what it was? Two birds. One aspect of medical care is that a real expert can take that vision and decide what it was. Okay, there are some things that we can do that sort of diagnostic step in. One flash and we've got the answer. But usually it takes great detail, and to be certain this is not another breed of a similar bird, you might even have to do a DNA analysis. That's one aspect of medicine. Black and white legal argument, as this is a comparison I like. For those who are South African, don't give the game away. We have a South African in the audience, I think, do we? Yes. This is black and white in South Africa. On your left is the black rhino. On the right is the wide mouth rhino, the white rhino. It was a misinterpretation of the word. But you add legal argument to the interpretation of whether they're different, and you come up with, there is no difference. I do digress. The earth being round and flat is a concept that I like to have gone and looked at the history of to some extent. And there was a lot of legal argument about the earth being flat. And then there was the presentation by Aristotle about the gradual disappearance of ships over the horizon, as you see in this picture. The shape of the curved shadow of the Earth on the lunar eclipse, the variation of the sun's elevation with latitude, the midnight sun, and then the fact that we see the Southern Cross in the south, but not in the north. And that things tend to collect in a globe. These are all arguments, scientific facts that suggested the world was round. Can I suggest to you that perhaps coronial medicine is a little bit flat earth? And I come to my subject of today. And what we should do as a collective of try and make not just coronial medicine, but the administration and regulation of medicine round earth. So let me proceed. I focused on the Victorian Institute of Forensic Medicine and taken some information from their website to show what their public face is, but to compare that with what is actually happening in reality. Truth conquers all. Isn't that fantastic? What a motto to have. The problem is that medical treatment-related deaths are investigated within a legalistic police investigation framework that is overseen by legally trained coroners. The current coroner of Victoria is the barrister who was in charge of the case against me, where the patient has had no adverse outcome and no complaint from the patient initially. And she tried to get me deregistered, and she got me recognised as deregistered in the public eye. Isn't that interesting? The Victorian Institute of Forensic Medicine is really the medical part of the coroner's court, and they look at deaths that are related to medical procedures, deaths where a doctor is unable to complete the death certificate, but have a bit of a reputation of the coroner looking at deaths from murder and so forth. Not so. 45% are due to natural causes that are investigated by the Institute, and 22% are unknown cause, and those more dramatic episodes are far fewer. But I thought, as well as looking at the motto, we might look at the values. Respect, openness, service, integrity, innovation. This is what they claim to be doing in the public eye. And what a great set of values. We'd have to say that we'd appreciate an institute with that sort of values. And I just want to focus on integrity. I want to go through four cases and then come back to that description of integrity and see whether their website reflects what they're really doing. We will be beyond reproach. We commit to truth, confidentiality, impartiality, and accountability. We commit to systems that are secure, reliable, accurate, valid, and safe. Four cases. The first case was the case that resulted in me making the inappropriate step of blowing the whistle without collegiate support, Brian. A girl died after a transplant. There was more recently the death of a child from pneumonia. Two of the audience members are related to the case number three, which was a death after an angiogram. And we have a community representative related to an unexpected death that I've looked at in detail. So I started looking at this case because I'd seen a series of adverse events that were being dealt with dismissively, and I'd seen bullying behaviour that was grossly inappropriate, and I made the decision, what would be the outcome of making a public statement? And I decided I'd probably lose my job. And if you're prepared to tolerate the worst outcome of doing that, then do it. So I decided I would lose my job by becoming a whistleblower, but I am proud of having lost my job. Tina died following a living-related renal transplant. The coroner was informed, but not informed of the concerns. I found out that it hadn't been notified appropriately because I'd held a meeting that included the coroner talking about autopsies and their role in quality of care. I said, did you know about this case? The answer was no. The external iliac artery had been tied off during the transplant. The leg died. The nursing staff were not told about the potential problem, and the patient died. So it was the conversation with the coroner that led me to my legal obligation of reporting the case to the coroner. It was investigated, but I was communicating with a policeman and the family to try and get the coroner to look at the issues that were real. It wasn't about targeting anybody that might have been involved. It was about finding what the problem was, so we solved it. But we had a policeman who started going down the burrow of it being an ICU problem, not a surgical problem. They looked for one surgical opinion, apart from that provided by me, that was considered jaundice. I was very careful to give an opinion that was related to the clinical facts, not because I had a problem with the institution where it had. And I was still working there at that stage. So, as I said, it was inappropriately reported by the hospital, and I was threatened subsequently for suggesting there might have been a problem. Focused on the ICU, not the poor surgery, and the report from the coroner's investigation, which was actually a coronial inquiry subsequently, was that an adult-style intervention was actually okay for a child, which is not true if you go and look at the literature about it. So I wasn't an expert in that, I'm not a vascular surgeon, but the evidence in the literature supported my view that the adult style intervention was not appropriate for the child. As I said, investigated by a policeman. And the next step was that the inquest was coming up. I'd been very involved in the preparation of material or encouraging them to go in the right direction to look for the questions, and I was excluded from the inquiry, any involvement in the inquiry whatsoever. They excluded the opinion they didn't want. The findings did not indicate that the problem was a surgery that led to the complication, not was the surgery that led to the complication, not the surgery for the complication. The next case that happened more recently, and I came across because of an involvement in Geelong, I noticed the Geelong papers, and it was a boy who died with pneumonia in the hospital. But the most significant part of this, to skip through quickly, is that the hospital took legal action to stop the coroner doing an inquest. The coroner subsequently found that there were problems that occurred, the hospital and a paediatrician were culpable, and that the patient, his parents, their perspective during the treatment was ignored. And I think the main point there is the hospital was using legal health dollars to stop there being an inquest into something that had happened in their hospital. And then John, unfortunately a 77-year-old, died in 2010 after an angiogram. It's complex, but basically the hospital was made to correct the death certificate. The clinical notes were not reviewed by the coroner for 5 months. The angiogram notes were not reviewed by the coronial service for 2.5 years. An expert offered an opinion on known incomplete notes. And there's a lot more to this story, but I'm just giving you a thumbnail sketch. In yellow is a real focus of this case for you, and that is, not only did the Geelong Hospital use our healthcare dollars to argue against an inquest, in the Supreme Court, with the family going to the Supreme Court requesting an inquest, the hospital and the coroner joined the legal teams together to argue against the family. Now, if that's what Australians want, then I want to leave Australia. That's not a standard that's acceptable. And by the way, the family has just received the complete pathology notes about a week ago. The death was in 2010. Okay, the expected unexpected death. An autopsy was conducted on a woman who died on the 7th of August 2009 and a diagnosis made of urosepsis. A complex background to this case, but suffice to have this summary to make the point about how the system doesn't work. If you go back through the notes, you see clearly that there was a recurrent urosepsis problem from 1999. There was no urine specimen taken on the day of admission 2 days before death. If they had have gone back to the notes, they would have recognised it was a problem. The discharge on the 5th of August 2009 was with a sodium of 129 on no drugs that would have resulted in that being okay. So clearly should not have been sent home. There was no process to review that result after the discharge. Noting the patient died with marked electrolyte disturbance and from urosepsis on the 7th of August, so 2 days later. Right, the autopsy. The autopsy report from the pathologist commented about the family. No comment about the history of the patient. There was no investigation of a potential drug reaction and no reference to the possibility of there having been urosepsis on the 31st of July. It was a result that should have resulted in a further urine test from the 31st of July, let alone the 5th of August, 2 days before death. The expert witness, after the family had challenged the outcome of the coroner for the investigation, they then, oh, all right, we'll get an expert. They got one medical opinion from a physician who was not a urologist or a nephrologist. That opinion said, on 5 August 2009, the patient was sent home with abnormal biochemical test and decreased renal function. There's a bit of a gap. Checking her urine for infection may have prevented her from re-presenting in septic shock. How does that fit with the next paragraph, the next thing that's written in that report? Overall, the management was of high quality. Get out of here. Okay, they don't connect. Now, you go to the coroner's report, who's a lawyer. The coroner is a lawyer, and that's the only opinion that he has used to make this conclusion. Sorry, I'm getting a bit emotional about this. On the evidence before me, a lawyer, I am satisfied that medical and nursing management was acceptable and within the parameters of reasonable healthcare practice. Following her discharge from the hospital on the 5th of August, and with the knowledge of her past medical history, which they hadn't reviewed, there was no indication that the patient would re-present just 40 hours later with overwhelming sepsis and in renal failure. There is a total disconnect between what the clinician said and their conclusion. There is a total disconnect from what the clinician said in their evidence and the conclusion of the coroner. Okay. There was a request for an inquest through the Supreme Court, challenged by the coroner and rejected by the Supreme Court. The coronial system doesn't appear to work. So the Victorian Institute of Forensic Medicine is where I get the sort of mission and vision, because there is none on the coroner's court website anyway, which says a lot. integrity. We will be beyond reproach. We commit to truth, confidentiality, impartiality, and accountability. We commit to systems that are secure, reliably accurate, valid, and safe.